Since the first coronavirus cases were detected in China in December, the United States has become the world's worst affected country. Case numbers in Florida, in Arizona, and South Carolina, seen here in red, are growing faster than in any other entire nation. And of the 25 top locations in the world for new cases, 15 are U.S. states. The U.S. coronavirus response has reignited the debate over American exceptionalism and its role as a leader on the global stage. Nick Schifrin has the story.
In Seoul's nightclub district, robots serve drinks in reopened bars. This was once a COVID hotspot. The government snuffed out an outbreak. In Paris, the Louvre reopened with mandatory reservations and face masks, a sign of France's relative success. And in Thailand, thousands of students returned to school, separated by partitions. Around the world, many countries are reopening and keeping case numbers low. But in the U.S., cases are accelerating and eclipsing even countries with large outbreaks, such as Brazil, Russia, and India, as the U.S.'s top epidemiologist, Dr. Anthony Fauci, acknowledged this week.
We went up, never came down to baseline, and now we're surging back up.
Across Europe, there are fragile success stories. Greece has one of the continent's lowest infection rates. The public face of its response has been not a politician, but an epidemiologist, Sotirios Tsiodras, who's so popular he got his own cartoon. Denmark was the second country to issue a lockdown before its first case. Last month, it reopened its borders to most European countries, but those in almost all European borders are still closed to American visitors. Meanwhile, in Asia, Vietnamese soccer fans pack stadiums after the country stamped out the virus with contact tracing and strict quarantine measures. And in Taiwan, sports bars and baseball are back.
When you have 15 people, and the 15 within a couple of days is going to be down to close to zero, that's a pretty good job we've done.
But in the U.S., experts fault President Trump's early denial, some states' failure to impose strict lockdown measures and quick reopenings, and a lack of testing and tracing, even though President Trump wants less testing.
If we did half the testing, we'd have far fewer cases, but people don't view it that way.
Today, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo insisted the U.S. was still a global leader.
Whether that is the technical scientific solutions, both to how to stop the spread, whether that's therapeutics or vaccines, the world turns its eyes to the best scientists and researchers. It's the United States that the world looks to.
But China and Foreign Ministry spokesman Zhao Lijian have tried to get the world to turn its eyes to Beijing to argue its communist system is superior.
China has achieved major strategic progress and brought the virus under control within a short period of time. Then we look at the U.S. We couldn't help but ask what and how the U.S. has done and when it will stop shifting the blame to others.
So how is the U.S. viewed around the world during the pandemic? For that, we get three views from three different regions. Jorge Castaneda was Mexico's foreign minister from 2000 to 2003. He's the author of several books, including most recently, America Through Foreign Eyes. Réka Szemerkényi was Hungary's ambassador to the U.S. from 2015 to 2017. She's now a non-resident senior fellow at the Center for European Policy Analysis, a think tank in Washington, D.C. And Maina Kiai was UN Special Rapporteur on the Rights to Freedom of Peaceful Assembly and Association from 2011 to 2017. He's a human rights and anti-corruption lawyer from Kenya. Welcome all to the NewsHour. And Maina Kiai, let me start with you. You go back and forth between D.C. and Nairobi. You happen to be in D.C. now. How do you and your colleagues talk about the U.S. and its response to the pandemic, given that you're here now?
Well, a lot of people in Kenya, in Africa, have been quite shocked, really, by how the United States has been dealing with this pandemic. The fact that it's elevated politics before lives, before science, and that this is a response that you would expect really from almost a third world country. The lack of leadership at the national level and the fact that things are going from bad to worse rather than improving. And so the luster, the sparkle that the United States has been for so many people has faded in a very dramatic way.
Jorge Castaneda, I'm wondering from your perspective, is this just about the question of the administration's response to COVID, or is this about bigger trends about the United States that perhaps began before COVID?
I think that's deeper trends and the things that I describe in my book, America Through Foreign Eyes, for example, the end of American exceptionalism or the increased sensitivity of the United States to what happens abroad, sensitivity or vulnerability or dependency, whichever you prefer. The United States in the pandemic is being seen, it should be seen, I think, as one more country that is affected by it. Some years ago, we would have thought the United States is never sensitive, is never dependent on what happens abroad, except every now and then, Pearl Harbor, 9/11. But the pandemic has shown that, on the one hand, the United States is as sensitive to these things as every other country in the world. And secondly, the United States is not exceptional in that matter. It is dealing with the same pandemic. It is dealing with a threat from abroad, pretty much like other countries are.
Réka Szemerkényi, let me come to you. We've just heard two arguments about how this is the end of American exceptionalism, but there are Europeans who still believe the U.S. is indispensable and who support the Trump administration's policies, even if perhaps not the rhetoric.
Absolutely. For a long time, you know, the questions that raised concern on the side of the Europeans were more the rhetorics, more the tweets that were coming out of the blue and that were not helpful to strengthening the transatlantic relationship. But the policies absolutely outweighed these messages, and the policies that were implemented so far have been very positive and strengthening this cohesion. Support for Ukraine, the support for a stronger cooperation inside NATO, the emphasis on the 2% as a fair and equitable contribution to the common defense were all seen as strengthening the alliance.
Maina, let me come to you. That notion that there are still U.S. policies that Europeans support, the notion that the U.S. is still indispensable, from some perspective, do you believe the U.S. can hold that special status despite the medical and financial crises it now faces?
Well, you know, the U.S. For many people in Africa was always seen as some place that we could learn from. And I suppose there's a difference between learning from U.S. as the people of the United States as differentiated from the government of the United States. So, for example, within this whole elements now, Black Lives Matter, it's had a lot of resonance in Africa, and a lot of people are talking about it and are seeing American people, multiracial, young especially though, out in the streets demanding a continuation of the dialogue to resolve the question of discrimination that's and racism that's been systemic and has been structural for hundreds of years. So it's one thing the way people look at the people of the United States as opposed to the government. Now, how this government and this regime is responding, for example, to this whole issue of Black Lives Matter, is one that again erodes the soft power, the attraction, you might say, of the United States.
Jorge Castaneda, you write about how these are longer trends that did not start with COVID, but to the point that was just made, do you see evidence that the U.S. is confronting some of those challenges and, as we Americans say, trying to craft a more perfect union?
Well, I think that the point here is that the United States really does look and acts increasingly like other rich countries. I would sort of place the Trump administration in brackets as an anomaly. If the United States looks like most other countries, it has to act like most other countries, and then it will become like most other countries. And perhaps what this pandemic is showing, as perhaps Warren Buffett would say, is that when the tide moves out in a financial crisis, everyone sees who's not wearing a bathing suit. Well, the United States is not wearing a bathing suit. It looks like just about everybody else.
Réka Szemerkényi, the Trump administration points out that this isn't only about how it has responded internally inside the United States, but what happened at the beginning of this pandemic and the fact that China silenced some doctors as well as scientists in the early days.
Well, definitely. I think the actions of China have revealed the real nature of the regime to the generation that has never seen authoritarianism or dictatorship. There is a very strong need of leadership and cooperation on the two sides of the Atlantic. We actually have to see through the current immediate reactions and have to see that strategically it is far more important now than ever to think of the transatlantic leadership relationship as a real priority for both sides of the Atlantic.
Maina Kiai, I wonder how you see the China challenge and whether you see the U.S. leading that challenge or whether you even see it as a challenge at all.
Quite a few people do not see a difference anymore between how the United States works and China works. And they see that both of them are interested in their own self-interest. And that's the most important thing for both. So it is a false narrative, a false choice to talk about China versus the U.S. as far as many people are concerned. The Chinese are giving quite a lot of loans that are quite painful in so many ways to Africa. The Americans are coming and wanting their own piece of the pie so they can be able to do their investments in different ways. So in a sense, I think trying to pit the world in this Cold War-like approach, it's China versus the United States, is a false narrative. And I think that both of them have been exposed within many parts of Africa as really not much difference. They just want a piece of Africa's resources. They want a piece of the pie to continue. In that case, then, for very many people in Africa, U.S. was always that beacon of hope, that beacon of democracy, that beacon of opportunity that people could come out and get to somewhere. But that has eroded dramatically.
Jorge Castaneda, the overall grade, perhaps, that you give the U.S. at this moment compared to, as you pointed out earlier, other rich countries?
I would put it sort of in the middle range, somewhere between the best and the worst. The question here is that the U.S. welfare state or American society clearly comes out as failing in the sense that it is not dealing with the pandemic, with the virus, the way, let's say, Germany is. We can see it with the American healthcare system. We have seen it with the federal organization of the United States, where some towns and some states do one thing, other towns and other states do other things. The federal government is in the middle, doesn't have enough money. So you look at all of this, you see a United States and American society that really needs to overhaul its social protection safety net.
Réka, Szemerkényi, last word to you. Do you believe that these challenges that the U.S. face, the U.S. can overcome them and continue to play the role that you believe the U.S. should play in the world?
If the United States is to be the leader of the free world, it has to be a completely new type of leadership that it has to exercise. It's a leadership that has to be based on cooperation. It's a leadership that has to be based on engaging partners and having delicate messages about the kind of positive messaging about the cooperation and the values of international cooperation. It can be a leader, but it has to be a new type of global leader, a new type that is based on respect and cooperation and engagement along common values in the long term.
Réka Szemerkényi, Jorge Castaneda, Maina Kiai, thank you very much to all of you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.